Go ahead and grab a seat and grab a Bible. Great to see you again. We've got a great chapter of the Bible we'll be looking at today, and I'll set it up for you this way. Have you ever seen this guy before? Someone has. It feels like, I don't know about you, it feels like half of everything I watch on YouTube starts with an ad with this brother on it, which might say more about my algorithm than anything else. Clearly, it does not work. if you have not seen this ad, here's what's going on here. So this guy will come on screen, and he starts, I mean, he is ripped out. Like, this was the most appropriate picture I could put in church, but he is just ripped out of his mind. And he'll say, like, "You think I got this way from eating pizza?" And I'm like, "Probably not." And then he goes on to say, "I didn't. Click below to find the secret." And I'll be real with you. Today's text is going to be a lot like that. Karen just in the front row, what? Let me explain. If you're just joining us, we are in this series through the book of Titus that we've called Growing Healthy Disciples. And the title really comes from this word that comes up on repeat throughout the book. It's the word hugiano, which last week we learned this. What does that mean? Or what English word do we get from it? Hygiene, thank you very much. Some of you are like, "That sounds like Greek to me." It's hygiene. And so it's a physical word that the Apostle Paul, when he writes to Titus, he uses in a metaphorical sense to talk about a type of health and vitality to life that Jesus came to bring us into. And but before we get into the message this morning, I just want to invite you to sit with this picture for a moment of healthy, vibrant living, not just with the muscles, not even really about muscles, but in a spiritual sense. Like, have you ever felt physically lethargic? Maybe I'll start in a way that's more relatable. Well, a couple of weeks ago, I had some dental surgery, and because of that, I was told I couldn't work out. I couldn't get my heart rate up, which some of you are like, "How does that differ from your normal life?" I like running. I don't get swole. I like to go running, but I couldn't do that. And so for a couple of weeks, I was totally unable to get the heart rate up, and I felt lethargic. I couldn't get out of bed, could hardly move from one task to the next and define the motivation. I felt physically lethargic. And I think what can happen a lot of times is that can happen to us spiritually, where we're not active spiritually, and so a part of our soul begins to wither. It begins to go into hibernation. It's still there, but you can begin to feel spiritually lethargic, relationally lethargic, and kind of like you're just coasting through your life. And if you can relate to that at all, I have good news for you this morning. The book of Titus is really a letter from Paul to a guy named Titus to help wake us up and to grow us back into a healthy, growing life again, to get us back on track. And if you're on track already, well, awesome. This book is going to help you get others on track and keep others growing. And by the way, the only way you stay on track is to keep others growing. And so I've made the case that this is a book for all of us, regardless of where you are coming from. And where we're going in the chapter today, you're like, "How does that relate to that brother from YouTube?" Here's what's going to happen in the chapter today. Paul has been talking so far in the letter in a theoretical sense about a healthy life, about a vibrant life, about a growing life. What he's going to do in today's text is he's going to move from theory to getting really practical about what does this look like for your life. He's going to move through different phases of life, older, younger, men, women, because different phases of life have different challenges and opportunities. Amen? Like, we were just at Chuck E. Cheese for one of our daughter's birthdays yesterday, and that had so much joy with it. It also had a lot of chaos and challenges when it came time to count up the tickets, and not every kid had what they wanted. See, I'm in a phase of life that some of you can laugh at right now, because that's not where you're at. And so what Titus chapter 2 is going to do is it's going to lay out for us, what is that healthy kind of Jesus-centered life? What is the more, the non-lethargic? What is the picture that Paul's going to give us of a vibrant life with Jesus? He's going to stretch that out over every phase of life, and then he's going to show us, how do we grow in that? So that's kind of the outline for this morning, kind of like the YouTube commercial. We're going to see the picture, and then we're going to talk about how to grow in it. And I think it's going to be a real practical message for you, and I will say this. I don't know if the YouTube thing works. My sense is it's a little too good to be true. I can tell you Titus chapter 2 is time-tested, and it works to bring us into the life that we're longing for. You ready to look at it? All right, Titus chapter 2, we will pick it up in verse 1 this morning, and we're going to do the whole chapter today. Should be a fun one. Let's see. Titus chapter 2 starts like this. But as for you, teach what accords with sound doctrine or healthy doctrine. That's our word right there that's on repeat throughout the book. It's going to come up 3 times in our chapter today. And like I said, what Paul's going to do is in this chapter, he's going to paint a picture of what life in step with Jesus, what life that accords with healthy doctrine looks like. And he's going to go phase by phase through life, so we'll just walk through it one at a time, starting with the older men. Verse 2. Older men are to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith and love and in steadfastness. Now, Paul doesn't give an exact age for what he means by older men, but if you pulled a muscle getting out of bed this morning, this is probably for you. the word in the original language, it simply just refers to someone who is past the age of having children. And so maybe a more modern equivalent would be like an empty nester. Kind of think that phase of life when he says that here. And what he says is, for those men in that phase of life, well, your life can be marked by a type of dignity that younger men look to, and when they see you, they say, that's the kind of guy I want to be like when I grow up. Anybody know someone like this in their life? Where every time they speak, you just lean in, right? You want to hear more. They're dignified. They're respectable. Now, if some of you are like, people don't lean in when I start talking, let me just encourage you to look at the rest of the list. Are you sound in love, like Paul says, or, and I tremble to say this, but I love you enough to preach the word, are you a little grumpy at times? Because these two would be at odds with one another. And look, to my fathers in the faith, I get it. There is a lot to be grumpy about. Particularly if you've been around for some time. If you've lived long enough, then there's a lot that you can get grumpy about and say, man, I can't believe the younger generation is doing this. I can't believe that we're going there. Like, I thought our generation solved that one. What are these people doing? But what Paul is saying is, without denying that reality at all, what Paul is saying is there is another way to live. That if you will allow Jesus, he will cause you to, the older you get, not get grumpy and cynical, but to grow warm and more loving and more sound in love the older that you get. To be the kind of man that goes through the ups and downs of life. And I'm not saying to be like deny the downs. I'm saying that I think our world needs more warm men who have been through the ups and been through the downs. They're realistic about both. And because they have seen both, that experience enables them to say with a type of steadfastness, keep going, God can be trusted, it doesn't end here. This is the vision that Paul is laying before us. That your experience, you've seen some things that we need to hear from. And if you will lean in and ask the Holy Spirit, grow me in love because I'm feeling the other thing flare up right now, you have an opportunity to be the kind of person that when you speak, your words have a weight that everyone leans in, that leads us to our own kind of steadfastness. And I think our world needs more warm men like what Paul is describing here, who are dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith and love and steadfastness. But I got to keep going. Paul next is going to address the older women. Now, he doesn't give an age for this one, and I'm not going to put a number on that. I'm just going to read the text. Verse 3. Older women, likewise, are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good. So what he says to the older women is he said, older women are to be reverent. Now, what does that mean? According to the book, it says, not getting drunk and blasting everyone for the crap going on in their life. Now, some of you are like, you just described every Thanksgiving dinner I've ever had. And so, okay, let's chat again. Like, to my mothers in the faith, like, I get it. There's a lot of nonsense in the world. You've seen some stuff, especially if you've been around for a while. And look, I don't know your story, but I know that in the island of Crete, in that culture, women wouldn't really have much of a voice in the wider culture. And so maybe you feel like when you're seeing the culture burning down around you, or your family or your friends burning around, maybe you feel like you don't have a voice to say or to do anything about it. And so all you can do is just sit around and talk about it and critique from the sidelines. What Paul is saying, and I hope you will see this, is that God is inviting you to get off the sidelines and play, because we need your voice. He says, teach what is good. So I want you to notice this. He doesn't say, like, be quiet and go home, like some fools would say today. He says, no, like, instead of complaining about what's wrong, could you help teach what is right? Because that's what we need. You have a perspective and a vision that, if you would bring it to the table, would help to make the whole world better. That's what Paul is outlining here. And look, if you do any studying of feminism, which some of you are like, you've definitely not studied feminism. I have. Being married to a strong woman and having 3 daughters will do that to you. And one of the things you find when you begin to study the history of feminism is actually women's suffrage came about as a result of men and really the entire culture realizing, like, we're making a mess of things, and there's a whole population whose voice we need to get in here. And so we need to bring that in, because there is a need to get this input, particularly as it came to women's suffrage around social issues of the day. The guys looked down and were like, we're making a mess. You see something good. Would you come in and help fill out our perspective? And I will say this, if the world can recognize that, the church should recognize it as well. And it's in the book from the beginning. Teach what is good. Not sit home and be silent, but get involved and get off the sidelines and get in the game, because we need your voice in this place. And so that's the kind of older woman that Paul lines out. Kind of similar to the older man, where dignified and reverent, like, they really sound very similar. Because there's something going on there. Your experience will give you a perspective that the rest of us need to hear. And so Paul's inviting you, get in the game and play. Being cynical is easy. Getting in the game is a lot harder, but this is the life Jesus came to invite us into. And part of that teaching, according to Paul, it involves teaching younger women how to fill in their roles. Listen to now how he's going to paint the picture for younger women. Verse 4. He says, and to so train the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind and submissive to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be reviled. Okay, I'm really going to try to make it out of this one alive. Let me start with what Paul's saying and then maybe address some of your questions. Paul is saying that younger women are to love their husbands and their children. And if you read the Bible, you will see that husbands and children, according to the scriptures, are a gift from God. But if you continue reading the Bible, you will also see that sometimes husbands and children do not feel like a gift from God. Sometimes husbands and children are difficult to love and hard to put up with, which is why what Paul, by the way, don't say amen. This is not the time right now. He's sitting right next to you, okay? Let me just preach the word. We'll let that sit, okay? Like, what he's saying here is that into that space, into that difficulty, you know what that's going to need? It's going to need some patience and kindness. It's going to need someone who's not irritable or rude, but who believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love like that is powerful. And this is what Paul is encouraging the women to. And so look, if you are a young mom, I just want to say on behalf of all of us, thank you. Because here's what I know. Doing this is often thankless work, right? Like, rare is the child who says, hey, mom, thank you for hanging in there and pressing in on my temper tantrum and not giving up on me, but pressing into my heart to engage my soul. Thanks, mom. Oh, your kids do that? Come on. Rare is the kid who says, mom, thanks for hanging in there and helping with my homework and not punt and give up, but to keep going. Thanks, mom. Rare is the kid, I mean, honestly, right? Like, where's the kid who even says, thanks for making breakfast, mom, right? And look, it's not just the kids. Like, sometimes I come home from a long day at work and I am so focused on everything that I've been doing that I am not at all dialed into all the things Karen has been doing around the home during the day. It is often a thankless job. And yet, what the scriptures say on repeat is the value that you bring at home to nurture up and to build is eternal. It can't be replaced. This is what Paul's getting at when he talks about working at home. Now, let me address a few things. This isn't saying that women can't work outside of the home. So breathe out. And the reason I know that, if you're like, well, now I'm angry in another direction, flip back a few books to the book of Proverbs, chapter 31, where you will see a much more detailed picture of the ideal woman. And you go to Proverbs 31, you're going to see she is crushing it in the marketplace, man. She is awesome. She is knocking it down like CEO running the biz. But what you will also see is well before it gets to that, it talks about how her heart is engaged at home. And that's the kind of thing that Paul's saying here when he says that women should be working at home. He's not saying that they shouldn't work outside of the home. He's saying that your heart should be engaged at home. And to not trade what is eternal and irreplaceable for something that certainly is. And look, I know that can be a hard word to hear in our culture because our culture tends to say your identity comes from what you do. Usually your job. And so look, I know in a culture like ours, it can feel like if you don't have a job outside of the home, then you don't have an identity, that you're like disappearing as a person. And what I want to say to you, if you feel that at all, is to stand on the word of God and say to my sisters, you have an identity that is greater than any job could ever give you. You are a daughter of the King. And you don't need some job to matter. You matter because you matter to Him. And that is your identity. And if you can receive that as an identity, what Paul's showing us is that frees you up to focus in some spaces that you can uniquely play in a way that would uniquely build others up. Again, it doesn't preclude doing more than that, but it should, I think, encourage us to not punt on that which is primary for that which is secondary. I feel like I've talked about women for too long. I need to say one other thing. Maybe you're wondering, like, well, what if I don't have a husband and kids? Right? Like, how do you apply that one? And what I would say to that is a couple of things. Number one, the main answer I would give you is that you have an opportunity right now, who knows about your future, you have an opportunity to be single like Jesus. And to impact this world through your singleness. You don't need to have, just like I said a moment ago, you don't need to have a job to be valuable. You don't need a man or kids to be valuable either. Like, your identity is set and secure in Christ. And so this gives you an opportunity to lean in and say, I am fully loved, fully valuable. And with the gifts I have, I'm going to go use it with where I can in the world. Now, Paul's writing into a culture where most of these women were married, and so I'm doing a little sidebar because our culture is kind of different today. So I would say, number one, you have an opportunity to be single like Jesus. Number two, though, I would also say that the scriptures will say that finding a good spouse is a good gift from God. And so if this is something you desire, then what I would say is pay special attention to what Paul's going to say to the young men next. Because I'm not going to pull the punches when we get to the young men, because I think I am one. I don't know if I've deluded myself into still thinking that. But let me just say this, that sometimes when we have a desire, but you haven't found someone, it's because the pool has been diluted by fools. It ain't you, it's the pool. And so what I'm going to do next is talk about the young men. So if you're single, you can be single like Jesus and press in. You are not a second-class citizen here. We need you. You have lanes. And we're going to talk about actually how to do it at work in just a moment that you can apply. But now let me talk about the young men so that you could maybe have a framework of what to look for. Because I would tell you, don't settle just to not be single because your identity's secure. Are we cool? Yep. All right. My wife said, yep, you're not single, hon. I'm just kidding. I appreciate you tracking with me. Thank you, hon. All right, younger men, verse 6. Likewise, urge the younger men to be self-controlled. Now, I read that this week, and I was like, one word? Like, the young women got two verses. And the young guys, we get one word? Are you kidding me here? But I actually think this is pretty profound. Like, let me say it this way. When you are younger, you have all this passion and energy, right? I think that's a great thing, obviously. Passion and energy is a great thing, but that passion and energy, it needs to be tamed. Otherwise, you'll be like an untamed horse. You'll have all this energy that could, like, power all this great stuff, or you could run people off of a cliff. And so passion and energy is great, but it does need to be tamed. And that's what Paul's getting at with this word self-controlled. This word self-controlled means sensible. It means keeping your head on straight. It's translated elsewhere in the Bible, serious. Because here's the thing, and I'm just going to lean in on the young men. I was gentle on everyone else. Guys, we're just going to have some real talk. Sometimes we're not very serious people. We have all this energy, and we're so into our sports team, and we're so into our hobbies, and we're so into, like, I read this stat this week. I wrote it down because I couldn't believe this. The average male has spent 10,000 hours playing video games by the age of 21. You know how long it takes to become an expert in something? 10,000 hours. And so it's like we have all this energy and we're spending all these. Look, I'm not the anti-video game guy. Like, this is not the sermon to say you can't play video games. Do it to the glory of God. But don't give your primary energy to video games when the world is burning around us and there are people to be loved and people to be protected and built up and encouraged and to use your energy to get in the game and to push back darkness and fight for good. That's why, yeah, someone's with me. That, I'll be real with you. Like, I was asking God this week, I was like, God, why'd you only give one word to the men? And, like, I'm not claiming this a word from the Lord, but this thought came to my heart. I'll leave my Bible and share it with you. Maybe God was saying, well, that's because you guys need to start here, and until you can get this one figured out, there's nothing more to say. I mean, what's interesting to me, to step back to the text, is self-control is not unique to young men. But it's like by the time he gets to the young men, he's like, ugh. Guys, you're sons of the king, you're valuable. This doesn't take away from any of that, but we need to start at square one here because you are not serious people. And the world is burning, and God has given you this energy and gifting and passion to get in the game. And so do not sell your passion for that which does not matter, but use it for what does. Exercise some self-control and get in the game. That's Paul's word to the young men. And brothers, I love you. I'm speaking to myself as I say these things. And so now hopefully at the end, or I've got one more, but if you were like, man, you came down hard earlier, hopefully you're seeing this is what the word of God does. It lays its weight on all of us so that we can see the more that Jesus is calling us to. But I've got one more here. Verse 9. Bondservants, or your translation might say slaves, but I don't think that's a very good translation because when you and I hear slaves, we tend to think of the type of evil that we saw in our country, and that is not at all what the Bible is talking about here. That was not present in the world. That was a later invention. And so I'm actually going to spend some time in this week's Cutting Room Floor podcast talking about the difference between a bondservant and what we know as slavery. And so if you want to dig into that more, if you've heard, well, doesn't the Bible support slavery? No, it doesn't. And if you want to hear more, check out this week's Cutting Room Floor podcast available on our website where I'm going to dive into that more. But for now, when you hear the word bondservant, just think employees. That's basically what's going on here. So employees are to be submissive to their own masters, or let's put it in historical context, bosses. To be submissive to their own bosses in everything. They're to be well-pleasing, not argumentative, not pilfering, but showing all good faith so that they may adorn the doctrine of our God and our Savior. Have you ever had a coworker like what was described here? Someone who has a good attitude, who is hardworking, who's not constantly trying to find a way to do the bare minimum to get by, but they seem to actively enjoy doing what is good, that when your boss asks for something, they don't roll their eye or speak negatively behind their back, but they give the benefit of the doubt and they do it even if it doesn't make sense because they know that they're on a team and everyone has roles to play on a team and they go for it. Has anyone had a coworker like that? Anyone have a coworker that's the opposite of those things? I got a little more response. Think about how much does that coworker just drag the whole workplace down? The one that's the opposite of these things. That when your boss says something, they start complaining and dragging on and talking bad about your boss. They're not hardworking, they're lazy and always looking to cut corners and take credit for your work. Well, I think what Paul's doing here is he's saying, look, in the same way that that kind of person brings the workplace down, a person who lives into this kind of way of living can lift the workplace up. So he says, don't be the guy or gal that when you show up to work, everyone goes, oh, they didn't call in sick today. Be the kind of coworker that people say, thank God she's here. Thank God he's here. Because this is the life Jesus enables you to play. Again, I'm not saying your boss isn't a fool. I'm saying your identity doesn't come from how your boss treats you. And if your identity comes from Jesus and being a daughter or son of the king, then that enables you to serve even a foolish boss. And this is the life Jesus came to lead us into. And so with that said, that kind of brings us all to the big question of how. So to any degree that you see wisdom in these things and you're like, okay, I'd like to grow in that. Now that I'm reflecting on it, I do see that kind of like the YouTube ad of, man, wouldn't that be nice? But I like eating pizza. How am I going to grow in that? Well, if you've been here at all throughout the series, I hope that you are already thinking. The way you're going to grow in that picture is through knowledge of the truth, which accords with godliness. If you're just joining us, that was the opening to the letter. Paul said we don't grow through kind of external pressure to change our behavior. You don't become a harder worker because the pastor makes you feel bad about being lazy. You become a harder worker by the beliefs at the center of your life being changed. By rooting out the lies that you are believing, replacing it with the truth, and out from the truth flows new actions into your life. That's the mega theme of Titus, that we don't change by white-knuckle effort outside in. We change by renewing our thinking at the very center of our lives. So that's what we've been talking about. But we also saw, right, last week that truth alone does not transform us. You can have right ideas in your head, but as long as you allow them to stay theoretical and don't take it down into your life, like, that's not going to produce sound or healthy or hygienic living. That's just going to make you someone that has a lot of theology and is annoying to argue with on the internet. And I mean, okay, so maybe you haven't been here in this series. Let me just ask you, haven't you ever found a time where you heard a truth that could transform your life, but it went in one ear and out the other ear? Anyone ever experienced this? I remember hearing a sermon on patience and being like, I need to grow in patience. And then I got out into the parking lot and someone was doing under the speed limit in the left lane once I got to the road. I'm like, are you kidding me? And then it hits me like, oh man, am I kidding me? In one ear, out the other, didn't affect my life. Like, I didn't even make it home from church. Man, you guys laughed way too much at that. That must happen way more often than I think. And so the question then is, okay, so knowledge of the truth is what changes us, but we've got to get it down into us for it to change us. Well, how? How do we get the truth down into us? And what I would say is Paul just told us. He says, older men are to teach the younger men. Older women are to teach the younger women. Effectively, what he's saying is that the way you take this truth down into your soul occurs through relationship. Through someone getting involved in your life, someone who is older than you, maybe not in terms of physical years, but at least in their walk with Jesus, someone who is farther along, putting their arm around you and saying, hey, we're going to follow Jesus together. And I'm going to help you work this out in your life, and I'm old enough to not be arrogant, to know that as I do this in your life, the Holy Spirit's going to use you in my life, and it's going to be this beautiful circular thing where we work in each other's lives. That's what Paul's laying out in this chapter. The way we grow in our knowledge of the truth that accords with godliness is through relationship. And it's so important. Like, if I have one burden today, I want to convince you of this. It's that we are not computers that simply need a software update. It's not like you come into church on Sunday mornings and I come in here and open up the word and use this to put new programming into your soul. This is part of the process. Speaking is necessary, but we are not simply computers that we could just do-do-do-do-boop, put in new data, and now all of a sudden we run differently. We are embodied creatures, relational creatures who have been designed by God in such a way that the way that we truly grow and develop and change does not happen in isolation as we do our own study, but it happens through relationship with others that we've opened our lives to in community. And I think this is why we get stuck so often, because in the modern West, we tend to turn Christianity into a solo project. We think, these are the things I'm going to work on, and then once I get that worked out, I'll get real with my small group. But I cannot tell my gospel community what's going on until I've figured some stuff out here. And what Paul would say is that's totally backwards. You're never going to figure that thing out until you get people in your life that will teach you these things, that you can teach them, that in that dynamic relational process, the God who is Trinity and designed you for relationship will show up and work it deep into your soul. I said this is really my primary burden today, so I brought something to hopefully drive this point home for us. It's kind of like this. Brick of clay I've got right here. And this is a season of life thing. I said earlier, every season has different challenges and opportunities. We're in the season where the kids are little and you want to press in and make their handprints so that you can remember that when they get older and they're being crazy and you can go, they were so cute once. And so we bought this in order to do that. And so if I want to put my daughter's handprint in this, if I handed this to her, and said, go off to your room and describe what your hand looks like. Tell this thing lots of truth about your hand. If she does that and hands me this back, in 10 years, I guarantee you all forget how small her hands ever were. Because talking at this thing is not going to change this thing. This thing is not a computer. You do not program code into it. The way that you can shape this thing is by pressing it down. And this was designed for little hands, not mine, so I'm only going to be able to give you a finger here, okay? But you press it down and you put your finger into it, and then all of a sudden we can see, oh, her thumb was that size. And that'll be cute someday. And I think this is kind of what's going on here, that what Paul's saying is we are not computers that need new ones and zeros. We are human beings designed in such a way that the way truth takes hold into our life is by people loving us enough to press it in, to get involved in our lives, and to press the image of this chapter into our lives by the power of the Spirit, to push it down deep. And that's the only way you can make these grooves, is that someone would love us enough to press it into our life and to shape us and mold us into the person that God called us to be. And look, I want today's message to be really, really practical, so I just want to give you real quick a great model that Paul gives us in the text for doing this. You may have noticed I skipped verses 7 and 8. Let me read those to you now. Paul says to Titus, he says, "Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. And in your teaching, show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may not be able to put us to shame, having nothing evil to say about us." Real quick, Paul gives Titus a framework for discipleship that involves two things. And in my experience, most failures I've had in discipleship, or if you're new to church, that word just means helping others follow Jesus. Most of the errors I've had in trying to love someone and to press truth and love and beauty into their life come from missing one of these two things. And so let me give them to you. Number one, he says, be an example, which means you got to let people into your life. You got to let the people that you're trying to press truth and beauty into their life, you got to let them into your life to see what you're really like. Because isn't it so easy to pretend on Sundays? How's it going? We have 90 seconds before the pastor comes up. I'll go for the good brother. How you doing? It's easy to pretend on Sundays. It's a lot harder to pretend if you invite someone into your home and into your life. But I will tell you this, some of the most profound discipleship that's taken place in my life, some of the times the Holy Spirit has most profoundly like put a new fingerprint in there on me, has happened is older men in the faith invited me into their lives. Sitting around the dinner table, talking about God knows what, I don't remember what we were talking about, and seeing the way they interact with their families, and seeing the way that things go down in their house. And look, not all of it was pretty. But I'll tell you this, seeing men that I respect say sorry when they are short or inconsiderate, instead of making excuses for it, like is my tendency to fire off 10 reasons to explain why what I did was rational, press something into me. And look, the Holy Spirit has a lot of pressing to get me into the image of Jesus that we're all being uniquely pressed into in our unique seasons of life. But some of those most profound moments happen around the dinner table as I'm seeing how does someone who's been walking with Jesus longer walk when that happens. And again, this is where We say this all the time, right? Like, truth is more often caught than taught. So Paul says, don't neglect the be an example thing. You can't do discipleship by just sitting someone down and trying to program new truth into their mind. You've got to open up your life and be an example. So you've got to share your life and open up and let people in. Otherwise, you won't be able to press in. But then number two, he says, teach the truth. He says, be sound in your words. See, a lot of discipleship models that recognize what I just said can sometimes miss the latter. They can, I've seen guys be like, hey, let's go get beer after service, and we'll sit down and we'll chat. And look, I'm not the anti-beer guy. If you wanted that pastor, you didn't get him. But let me just say this. If all you do is sit and drink together and talk about your life, but you never get into talking about the truth of God's word, then what you have is a drinking buddy, not someone who's discipling you or you are discipling them. See, eventually what needs to happen in life on life is at some point, as people's lives are open to you, you are going to see things that are out of step with this book. And it's always easier to see it in other people's lives than yours, isn't it? That's why we need each other. And when you see something out of step, I think sometimes we don't love people enough to tell them what we see. We just remain drinking buddies, and we never get into, man, why did you react like that? That seems off to me. Tell me more about that. Tell me more about why you reacted to that thing at work. Like, are you finding your identity in your job? Is this shaking the core of who you are? Eventually, you have to begin to teach the truth. Now, there's a formal and an informal way I think we can do this. But I think we all need this. So formal discipleship could look like maybe your takeaway from this sermon is you're going to find someone and you're going to say, hey, would you disciple me? Would you do Titus chapter 2 with me? Could we do this together? That'd be a real formal way. And you meet up and you create a plan for sharing life together, then sharing truth with one another. You could do that really formally, and I've done that with some great results. I will also say, depending on your season of life, that might not be very realistic. And so a more informal way we've tried to build out here at Fair Oaks is what we call gospel communities. These are groups of people who gather together all over the valley every week to get together and open up our lives to one another. And we don't have an agenda for what we're going to talk about. Maybe we'll use the sermon as a launching off point, or maybe the sermon wasn't very good today. We'll start with something else. But we're going to open up our lives to one another, and as we open up our lives to one another, as we have opportunity, we're going to share the truth with one another. That's the two things our gospel communities do. We share lives, and we share the truth about the gospel and Jesus and all he is and all that he has for us. And this is the way that we grow. Whether you do it formally or informally, we need this. Otherwise, truth will be in one ear and out the other ear. And here's what I'll say about our church. Here's what I love about our church. I'll be real with you. This was a hard sermon to prepare because I'm like, I have to say a lot of hard things. But I really genuinely love you. And so this is the part that I save this for last because this is the best. Here's what I love about our church. We have a lot of older men and younger women in the faith here. I love that about our church. Our younger population has also more than doubled in the last year. And so I look at our church and I love the age diversity that God has given to us in this place here. I mean, go ahead and look around and just see it. Not every church is this way. I love the diversity of age that God is giving us here. And so I was studying this week, and I was like, I wonder if we really just did this. Like, what if we became a Titus chapter 2 church where we not only learn truth on Sundays, but we press in through relationship all week long? Because that's really the big idea of this whole message, that truth is applied through relationship. And what's the value of coming together for Sundays and filling your head with all of this truth if you don't have any relationships to process it with? So I just think, like, what if we were a Titus chapter 2 church where I've been in churches with Karen where we're the old folks? It's not a good setup. Not so here, though. I might fall into the younger folks category. And so we have such an opportunity to do this in three dimensions, to take the truth and to press it into our lives. And so I just wonder, what if we did this? Because here's the thing. My hope for this series is not that you would leave with some new tidbits about discipleship. My hope is not that you would just leave with new facts in your head, but that God would use our time in Titus to breathe a type of discipleship revolution in our church, where older men and women began to look at younger men and women and put their arm around them and say, hey, I want to walk with you through life, and I want you to walk with me through life, and I want to do this together because I've been around long enough to know that this is how it happens. That's my hope for this series. And so one thing I want to ask you as we close here, how do you need to be discipled or to start discipling someone? And just know that's a circle. If you need to start discipling someone, you're going to get discipled in the process. But maybe you're new to your faith and you just need to go to someone around you and say, hey, I don't mean to offend you. You look like you might possibly be older than me. Would you walk with me? Like, if it's true that truth is applied through relationship, don't you want to grow? Don't you want this to happen in your life? And so how do you need to disciple someone or be discipled by someone? Because a discipleship revolution will not come through preaching a message about it and getting you riled up and sending you on out. A discipleship revolution will occur as the Holy Spirit gives us the faith to believe God's word that he has more for us than we know, and that as we get involved in these messy relationships, we might taste and see a bit of that. And look, if you're thinking, not me, my life is a mess, I couldn't possibly help someone walk with Jesus, let me just lovingly say this: get over yourself. Because look, you are not the content of your discipleship. You're not saying to someone, hey, come follow and learn to be like me because I am awesome. What discipleship is, hey, come with me as I'm trying to follow Jesus, and maybe I've learned some things along the way that could be of use to you, and maybe some of my errors, God's going to use you to avoid paying the stupid tax so you don't have to live those same errors. That's the thing. We're not saying, come follow me. We're saying, let's follow Jesus together. Would you do that with me? And so if you're thinking, I don't have much to offer someone, get over yourself. You're not the content of your discipleship. Jesus is. And that's how Paul closes this. So let me read Paul's closing words, and then I'll pray for us. And I'm like, some people are ready to worship and get out. Let me just read you the closing words, because this is the best part of the chapter. After all this, he says in the end, verse 11, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, to live self-controlled, upright and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Declare these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority, and let no one disregard you for this. What Paul says at the end of a very long chapter that presses on us in ways that are uncomfortable is, man, why should you want to renounce some things that maybe feel good, but the word of God would call it a worldly passion? Why would you want to renounce those things? It's because of the grace of God. I don't know how you hear this sermon today, but let me just tell you this. God's love for you is not based on how well you live into Titus chapter 2. It's not based on how well you disciple other people. The whole point of the gospel is that God loves us when we were at our worst. That his love flows from his heart. That there's nothing we could do to make him love us more, and there's nothing we could do to make him love us less. This is the heart of the gospel. This is what Paul is talking about when he says the grace of God has appeared. And it's not a theoretical idea like God is gracious. He says the grace of God has literally appeared in the person and work of Jesus. In him, we see that God loves us and is for us no matter how much worldly passion is in us. And he loves us enough to lay his life down on the cross to die in our place for our sins so he can rise again and offer us a new kind of life that grows in a purity and wholeness of life. That one day he's going to give it to us as a gift when we arrive in glory. But the point of the book of Titus is he wants to grow us in that life now. And the way that we grow into that is not by looking down and feeling bad about all the ways we fall short or we can't help others grow. It's as we get our eyes up to Jesus and see his grace for us that Paul says that is what trains us and changes us and actually gives us the power to renounce these things that sometimes we're clinging on to. And that right there, I would submit, is the primary truth we need to keep pressing into one another. Not just that Jesus has more for you. That's what I've tried to do with Titus chapter 2, is to show Jesus has more, I think, for all of us than we know. But the primary truth that we need is that God loves you more than you know. That's why we always end every sermon this way with Jesus. And I love telling you week after week, church, God loves you. He is for you. It doesn't matter what you did this week. His heart towards you is kind. And so as we respond to this message, we're gonna invite you in just a minute to come to the table and to taste and to see and to take that reality down into your physical body in such a way that the Holy Spirit will renew your soul this week. Before we do that, I just wanna pray a word of blessing over us, and then we'll come and take some time to respond to these things. But this is the main truth we need to hear. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for loving us. Even on the weeks we're not very lovely. I thank you for sending Jesus for us to show us that your love isn't an abstraction, but that your love is real and personal, and that you're the kind of God who would die for us to bring us home. And so, God, where this chapter has been disorienting for us, I pray that you would send your Holy Spirit to help us understand these things. Just as you inspired Paul to write to Titus, would you, Holy Spirit, lift our spirits to understand what you are saying to us this morning? Help us to know the truth, primarily the most important truth in the world about our Savior Jesus Christ, that we might be a people for your own possession, who are zealous for good works, who are walking in a type of health and vitality that the world around us will see and think it's like a YouTube ad, too good to be true, but they want to get in on it. Would you work this type of discipleship revolution in this place for your glory and our good? In the beautiful name of Jesus, I ask. Amen.